let us get immediately to work using a new format here because all the other ones have failed. Thank goodness I purchased I got a great deal on a webcam, not a webcam, camcorder. And I'm able to use this now. The only problem is the audio. I don't have a microphone here, so I can't talk real loud. I'm outside and neighbors are around. And so hopefully you can get the audio. You may have to turn up the audio on your video on YouTube in order to get this. Happy Mother's Day, and we'll get right to work. The fact is that existence is an imaginary past. And who's imagining it? Spirit chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, which gave rise to an instant effect of annihilation, which reality cannot be annihilated at all. So how do we experience annihilation? As symbolized, mind has to symbolize it as total mental chaos. We could not tolerate this effect, so the mind immediately presented something the mind said is prior to this effect, and that is what's called time. The mind said, oh yeah, that, don't worry about that effect, there's something that came before it, and that what came before it is time, a past. It has, supposedly this effect has a past to it. And what mind is telling us we need to learn in time is learn how to accept total mental chaos, how to get used to it, because that would be necessary, mind says, in order to be prime creator. We have to be able to handle this effect. We have to be able to bite in it happily. It was just completely impossible. So time is inherently bringing us destabilization, little bits of chaos called destabilization. Total mental chaos is complete destabilization without any reference point whatsoever. Whereas time is gradual destabilization, where partial destabilization, where there are still reference points. Okay, and time does this to try and teach us lessons, the lessons of time, as it's called. Time says existence is a classroom, that we must learn the lessons of time. And of course, what else is it going to say? It has to give us this spiel, this marketing spiel. Of course, we don't have to believe it. We can say, wait a minute, I understand what's going on. This is all because I chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. I can choose a new idea, no trouble at all. Then I don't have to deal with time at all. So time again, we as we're experiencing this with a person, bodies, people, forms of expression, communication, how we express ourselves through all different ways, and music and speech and clothing and relationships and all this stuff, it's all an imaginary past. It's all an imaginary past. We're saying, what if all this were possible? What if there could be a past to an effect? Before the effect arises, there's something else that arises, which is, of course, just imaginary. It's impossible. Cause and effect and reality are one. They're instantaneous. Two sides of one coin. There's no way to say, well, I choose an idea, and then before I experience the idea, there's some other experience of a past of time. Reality is not that way at all. It's impossible for reality to function that way. So this is the situation we're in. We believe we're in. And so how do we deal with the situation? Say, I am and time isn't. I am and I have no past. I was created right now. My identity is right now, and there is no past. We use declarations are the most powerful tool. It's like using a digging hammer, you know, electrical digging hammer, instead of like digging with your hands. You're trying to get through some tough, heavy concrete, or, you know, let's say there's concrete. How are you going to break it with your hands? You know, are we going to wait for it to gradually dissolve through time? It'll be waiting a long time. You get a digging hammer, jackhammer, and just absolutely demolish it. So declarations are the demo tools that we use to wake up, realize what's going on, to realize. We can realize and say, hey, this is all just a what-if scenario, where we're trying to teach ourselves how to learn to love total mental chaos, total chaos. So the lessons of time are not good ones at all. They're not nice ones at all. And of course, since it's partial, we're trying to be, you know, gently lead us into how to get used to total mental chaos. So we gradually, partially, we seem to have thing, you know, seem to have some stability around us. At least it appears that way, even though it's not, because the rug can be pulled out from underneath us at any moment, right? At any moment, in any which direction, which happens all the time. Which is time's purpose, is to pull the rug out from underneath us. That's time's purpose. The purpose of all of this is to pull the rug out from underneath us. And then we wonder, oh, why is God this way? And people say, well, God is so mysterious. No, God's not mysterious. It's time that seems to be mysterious because we're not willing to recognize what it's doing. But it's really not mysterious at all. There is no mystery anywhere. Time is simply functioning, doing its thing, what it needs to do, in order so we can continue this preposterous whim of wanting to be prime creator, continue to entertain this idea. We say, well, we can keep entertaining this idea because we're working on the problem that arises with this idea, the problem of annihilation. We're trying to get used to annihilation, as it were, bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, life after life after life after life. So if this whole situation isn't resolved and we don't choose a new idea, then we just continue cycling through. We have the rug pulled out from underneath us continuously, whether at some point these bodies will die and then we'll be in the afterlife, and then at some point in the afterlife the rug will be pulled out from underneath us and we'll find ourselves back in some world again with a body full of disintegration and destabilizations, and we'll try to dodge death for a while, and eventually the rug gets pulled out from underneath us again. And the fact is, that is existence. That is existence. There's no way to sugarcoat it. The more you sugarcoat it, the more diluted, the more you're delaying. There's no point in trying to sugarcoat it. That is exactly what existence is. There is nothing about existence other than that. And again, we have little crumbs of, you know, we have a few flowers in our life, basically, before the petals fall off. For a little while, we get to watch the flowers until the petals fall, and that's it. But the good news is that we can wake up from this dream, and what we do, we can be in a semi-awake state in which we experience an overlay of this dream of impermanence, of destabilization, which is called bliss. All right, we can do that, and I've gone into that at length in other videos. But it's important to understand the overview of the situation, that literally what we're experiencing is an imaginary mirage, like of some hypothetical past of what if effects were not experienced simultaneously with cause. But what if there was something else prior to that effect that was different than the effect, that was some kind of precursor, that what if, and that is this mirage of existence, as it were, this dream of existence. So how to awaken from this dream, how to recognize it, how to realize what we really are, is the quest. It is the quest. And it is not an easy quest. And there are those who have awoken, and they help, they reassure us we can do it. But it's a tricky thing. It's a tricky thing, really. And the reason why we spend so much time on it is because it is so tricky. And the resistance does seem to be so vague. We can't pin it down. We can't pin it down. And we go through all these twists and turns, and we see it one way, next day we see it another way. It's so elusive. It's so very, very elusive, as it were. And yet we can get to it. And the best way to get to it is through declarations. One minute. Spiritual declarations. I am and time isn't is one of the core ones you can use. I am and time isn't. That just, when we make declarations, it kind of puts us in a different frame of mind, as someone pointed out. You get a little epiphany. It's like, whoa, just something is different. I am and time isn't. You're suddenly speaking from your true nature instead of from the standpoint of time. You see, time tries to bully us and tries to be the authority over us and tell us what to do because it says, hey, in order for you to be prime creator, time has to be in control. You have to bow to the lessons of time. You have to learn the lessons of time. So time seems to be the teacher. Okay, it seems to be the teacher, seems to be in control. And so spirit submits to that, tends to submit to that. We cannot keep submitting to time like that. We have to take, spirit has to say, whoa, wait a minute. No, I am and time isn't. We're not in a dialogue with time because time has one purpose. And it's an effect. It cannot change its purpose. It's not a cause. It's pretending to be a cause. It's not. So it cannot change. A dialogue is useless with time. Making a deal, a bargain, is useless with time. What we have to do as spirit is choose a new idea and say, let me choose for the sake of continuity another hypothetical of what if I couldn't be prime creator? What if I wasn't trying to be prime creator? Then I wouldn't need a past. So we say, well, what if I don't need a past? So we get this feeling of, I don't need this past. Okay. But we maintain the past, it's still there, but we're feeling, hey, I don't need this past. What I am doesn't need this past at all, and that's called bliss. What I am doesn't need this past. I am, and I don't need a past. I am, and the past is nowhere. I am, and the past is nothing. These declarations open the door for bliss, which is a conscious feeling of, I don't need any of this past. I feel complete. No matter what is happening with this past, I feel whole and complete. And nothing is disturbing how this sense of seamless completeness. So, let the neighbors walk by. So I am and the past is nothing. I am and the past is nowhere. I am and the past is nowhere. I am bliss. I am in bliss and the past is nowhere. I am in bliss and the past is nowhere. So we're not dialoguing with time here. We're not dialoguing. We don't have a dialogue with time. We're not cutting a bargain. We're saying, time, what do you want me to do? Because we're so used to time being the teacher and feeling that we need to learn the lessons of time, that time, we've felt for so long that time is our guru. And that time can deliver to us this great goal we have of being prime creator. So we value time so much and the lessons of time. We're so willing to go along with time. So it's a huge turnaround to just saying, I am and time isn't. You see, we think, oh, where's our teacher? We're going to lose our teacher. So that is the difficulty we have on the path. You know, theoretically it's simple, but practically we are, again, so accustomed to submitting to time as the teacher that it just seems like an incredible turnaround to make to no longer submitting to time and saying, time, you're nothing. You've never been anything. I've never needed you. That's true because I can never be prime creator and I can always choose a new idea. So I never needed time to teach me how to do the impossible. So even though it sounds simple, practice is essential. Had a dream last night where something representing the past, something that came before me. Past means something that came before you, what I am. I had a guitar and said, I want to get this guitar, electric guitar. And they said, is it any good? Is it any good? And I said, I think I recommend it or something. I recommend it and they're playing. And they're hitting these chords, bomb, bomb, bomb. And it's just horrible distortion, horrible distortion. And I say, whoa. I say, whoa, wait a minute. You got it plugged into the wrong amplifier. And I I unplugged it from one amplifier and I plugged it into a small little amplifier. I said, this is the right amplifier to plug it into. And then I took the guitar and I hit some chords and it was still didn't sound good. I said, what's wrong? And I checked the controls and all the controls were set all wrong. And so the wrong amplifier, wrong controls, everything. And I readjusted the controls and then I started to play and I got this, you know, incredibly beautiful sound out of the guitar. So the past is a complete distortion. It is all added, it is all set all wrong. It doesn't, that is not the sound. We don't sound this terrible distortion sound, no. Actually, we're beautiful and clear and our tone is so clear. But the past has got all our controls all in the worst possible type of mode, right, to destabilization. So the past is always playing this horrible song, really. Sound is terrible. It's terrible. But we can take the past away and say, no. We're going to overlay it. We're going to set things, give a different purpose to all these forms that we have imagined. And we say, this is no longer the past. This is right now. In other words, I'm not experiencing any effect from any of this. I have steady state. Steady state, very clear, very beautiful, very melodic, and we can do that. So there is progress that is made, but it is difficult to recognize the progress on the spiritual path. It is difficult. It takes faith. The main thing is if you can keep trying to shift from petitions to declarations. All right, that's a goal. It's not easy. It's taken me a long time. Very difficult, actually. Because we keep petitioning. For instance, here's another one. We say, God, please protect me. Please protect me. That's a petition. That is saying I am different than what God created me as. That I am vulnerable and in danger, etc. What we really should be doing is saying, I am and vulnerability isn't. I don't need any protection. I don't need any protection. The past doesn't need any. I don't need to be protected from the past. See that? I am, and I don't need to be protected from the past. The past is nothing. I don't need to be protected from the past. The past isn't. I don't need to be protected from the past. The past isn't. So this is one of the main things we do in petition. We're asking for protection. I was just doing that yesterday. I said, oh my gosh, I'm really worried about a situation. I need protection, protection. I said, oh, wait a minute. That's doing emphasizing my vulnerability. Let's change that. Let's turn that into a declaration. I am complete, I need no protection. I am, the past isn't, I need no protection from the past. I am, the past isn't, I need no protection from the past. Jesus said something very interesting in ACIM. He said, my perfect safety lies in my defenselessness. And I said, huh? What are you talking about? You know, but it's true. If you eventually you say, "Wow, see, I need no defenses, for I'm invulnerable." How can that which is invulnerable need defenses? There's no need for it. There's no need for it whatsoever. So instead of emphasizing our need for defenses and protection, I turn it around 180 degrees. See, I need no defenses. I need no protection. I am, and time isn't. I am in bliss and the past is nowhere. Okay, I am in bliss and the past is nowhere. I need no protection from that which isn't and is nowhere. God created me perfect. I need no protection. I am perfect. I need no protection. And that wakes one up from the dream. Of course, time is constantly destabilizing all these symbols. And as long as we think that these symbols are real, then we'll feel we need protection, etc. But we need to realize we're the dreamer of the dream. So the dreamer of the dream has to identify themselves as what they really are. And we can't make a false identification. It has to be a true identification. And the fact is, the dreamer of the dream is invulnerable. We are invulnerable. We don't need any protection. I am invulnerable. I need no protection. Say that. I am invulnerable. I am eternal and invulnerable. That is the dreamer then declaring themselves, saying, yes, I am here. This is what I am. And really, what protection does the dreamer need from the dream? None really at all. All I need to do is realize that it is their dream and not someone else's dream. Not something of someone else in control somehow. But we're the dreamer of the dream of the past. The mind is doing this on our behalf. So we are the dreamer of the dream. I am, and time isn't. I am not in, my spirit is not in competition with time. I am is not in competition with time. I am is not in competition with time. I am in bliss, and time isn't. I am in bliss, and time isn't. I need no protection, for I am perfect. So this is a very different way of looking at the situation. Ordinarily, we petition, and we say, "Time, you're really scaring me. Can you at least help me out?" We believe there's some kind of God of time, God of the past. And this God of the past, if we petition this God of the past will protect us from the worst, you know, at least temporarily protect us from having the rug pulled out from underneath us. But of course, eventually it does. So we just kind of say, okay, can you delay the torment, the destabilization a little bit? Can you delay it a little bit? We'll do anything, just delay it a little bit. That's not God. There's no God of the past. God says, just declare what you are, make your declarations of what you are, what you really are. And that's what frees you from the past. You realize, hey, I don't need any past. What I am needs no past. What I am needs no past. What I am has no past, needs no past, needs no protection from the past. I need no protection from the past. Because the past is nothing and nowhere. It's like saying we petition, we say, I need protection from nothing. No, we don't. We don't need protection from nothing. We need to choose a new idea. Let me see if I can hit something here on this camcorder. All right, there we go. So this is the first time trying this out, recording with the camcorder. Hopefully the audio is being heard. I don't know. I have to get close to the camera in order to. I wish there was a could plug in a microphone, but no. So the progress is from petition to declarations. I know those that get a sense of who they are urge everyone just. Accept this is what you are. It seems, you know, seems like, wow, this is so great, just accept it. But very few do. And because they don't put everything in the right context, they don't practice going from petitions to declarations. It's necessary to continue to work at it and work at it and work at it and work at it. So talk is necessary. Practice is necessary. It should not be looked down upon at all. Now, of course, when the dreamer wakes up, this seems very simple. They say, oh my gosh, it was just a dream. What's the big deal? Come on, everybody, just wake up. What's the big deal? Now, it is a very, very entangled web because time is a liar. And we have willingly listened to these lies for so long that we have a tremendous fear that if we recognize that time is nothing, that we'll be annihilated and we won't be ready for it. There's a feeling like we're not ready for something yet and we need time to help us. There's that feeling. So we feel like, oh my gosh, time might get angry at me and not teach me what I need to learn. And then I'm going to be annihilated. I'm going to suffer horribly. I'll be cast into the pit of hell if I, you know, don't learn the lessons of time. I'll burn forever, you know, that kind of thing. And so we're really shaky, shaky, scared, scared, scared to really recognize that I am and time is nothing. So it's not a joke. Spiritual path is no joke and should be recognized as such. You have the great teachers who have told us this. They're saying, hey, you need to make it your career, make it your life's work. If you have to work, make it your hobby. You know, a lot of people have hobbies and they put more time into their hobbies than they do their work, which is so the spiritual path has to be your hobby. If you can't make it a career, make it your hobby. And don't worry about trying to express yourself beautifully in time. That's a waste of time. There's not one, none of the great teachers in this world have ever tried to make their self-expression something of importance in this world whatsoever. You know, it's not like they realize that they're the dreamer, they realize they have no past, they don't need any past, and they're in bliss, and then they say, oh, okay, well, let me start composing a whole bunch of music then, because I, you know, or something, or let me write a whole bunch of poetry, or let me develop some dance, or let me wear all these beautiful, bright clothings, or whatever. Now, usually they're just very quiet and in bliss, and you know, Shankara said, hey, you need a lifetime. It's really difficult. You have to really go at it from every angle. And very sober type of thing. You're not trying to say, hey, let me brighten time up by composing symphonies or something. Let me brighten everybody. Let me brighten time up or something. No. They don't do that. So for some reason, self-expression here in time, in the past, is unimportant. They de-emphasize that entirely. The real heavyweights, they say, no, forget it. That only delays you more, because what you're trying to do then is trying to, what you're saying is, I gotta learn the lessons of time, but I'm feeling like I just wanna quit, so won't somebody give me a beautiful song so I can at least keep marching down this dreary road, at least with a song, and keep at it. That's really what people are asking for. They say, please, please, can you not compose some music for me? Can you not tailor some wonderful clothes? Can we not have a beautiful life? Can we not have everybody expressing themselves beautifully here? So they want to make time a little nicer. They want some crumbs of comfort in time. And they think that those who realize the self and bliss somehow should be able to get that feeling of bliss through to people in time so they can... Why? The question is why? If you could be in bliss, why would you spend your time trying to get crumbs of... You know, let me go to a fashion show and look at all these exotic fashions or something. Why would you do that? Again, it's to maintain loyalty to time that people ask for that stuff. It's to maintain loyalty to time. So they can learn the lessons of time, because they believe that's absolutely essential. If they don't learn the lessons of time, they feel they're not going to be prepared. When annihilation comes, they won't be able to handle it effectively. Well, of course not. Nobody can handle total mental chaos effectively. The only way to handle it is to jump back from it and say, oh, I can't handle that. That's it. Doesn't matter what kind of preparation you have. When there's absolutely no reference points whatsoever, endlessly, with no possibility of ever establishing one, that is something you cannot help but jump back from. Doesn't matter if you spend billions of years trying to steady your mind and practice all this stuff about trying to steady your mind, do this, that's again trying to learn the lessons of time. Okay, we don't need to steady our mind. We need to make declarations. And I am and time isn't. And feel that. That is a declaration from Spirit. Spirit is saying this: I am and time isn't. Meaning, I have no interest in time. I have no interest in the lessons of time. I don't need the lessons of time. I understand the whole situation now. I see it. I am and time isn't. And I'm not trying to develop any abilities in time. I'm not trying to develop any abilities, because ultimately all the time is interested in is how to in how to abide in total mental chaos, how to abide in that. As if we can learn how to abide in that, then we will magically be transformed into the new prime creator. So of course we can spend lifetime meditating, trying to be calm. This, I am calm in all circumstances. Everything around me is falling apart, and yet I can keep my mind steady. I can keep my mind steady. So that's not the goal of enlightenment. Not at all. That's a goal of time. That is a goal of time. We're not trying to keep our mind calm in the midst of disintegration. Okay. The Lord's saying, I am bliss. I am bliss. Okay, this is from a different idea. And it's effortless. I'm not trying to keep calm even though I'm aware of all this disintegration. I am overlaying everything right now and saying none of the past has anything to do with what I am and never will. And therefore, it is nothing. I'm not affected by anything. It's different. It's different than being in time and trying to maintain. It's like someone being tortured and they're trying to keep themselves from screaming, you know. And they can say, I got great discipline, great self-control. Okay, that's not enlightenment. Enlightenment would be that the torture is going on and nothing is happening. It is as if nothing were happening. And there's no more significance to that than anything else. And there's no self-control being employed whatsoever. There's no, like, technique being employed at all. It's not a technique. Enlightenment is not a technique. Time would be like you're in a dream. You have these figures in a dream, and one of the figures is being tortured, and you try to get the figure in the dream to not break down from the torture. But the dreamer is not aware that it's a dream, so there's still this dream element, whereas the dreamer waking up from the dream, they say, oh, this is all nothing. This never had any effect on me. None of this ever had any effect. In fact, it's not having effect on anyone. There's no effect at all. So it's different. It's quite different. Usually when people start on the spiritual path, it is they're just trying to say, okay, I have to succeed at the lessons of time, and there must be some techniques I can use. So let me get meditate and yoga and do all this stuff, and so I can be one pointed and I keep my mind steady. So when I go into a mental chaos, I can remain steady. But it doesn't work, because there in reality there's an experiencer and an experience, and the experiencer and the experience are simultaneous, and yet there's still a chooser and a presenter, their spirit and mind. So when you're looking at total mental chaos, there's still someone looking at it. But what they're looking at is completely chaotic, which is no experience at all, as it were. And so the experiencer says, whoa, that's no experience. I don't want that. That is not what I was created for. So it is not possible to do away with the experiencer. We keep thinking, maybe we just no experiencer, then that'll succeed. No, it's not true. Not true at all. Or if we have something else, we just discipline ourselves to not want on any experience. Say, well, no, I'm just totally into my own control, through my mind, and experience doesn't matter. That doesn't work either. Doesn't work either, because we were created to experience. So we cannot do away with either the experiencer or the experience. But both have to be there, and since they both have to be there, we cannot abide in total mental chaos. It's impossible. So the lessons of time are simply wasted lessons. They're futile. But we start out on the path saying, teacher, can you teach me discipline? Can you teach me how to discipline myself? So when total mental chaos is there, I say, I don't care, it doesn't bother me. I'm not even paying attention to it. I'm still centered, you know. So everyone's trying to find some way to handle this experience. There is no way to handle it. There is no way to handle it. So once you realize that, a totally different path opens up for you. And you say, wow, all this other stuff doesn't work. What do I do now? And then you start to turn things around. Start to turn things around. But in a culture where they've lost this clarity of all this, it seems like the turnaround is tough. Certainly, I tell you this, that you do not want to throw away even the slightest bit of clarity in the world that's been, the momentum has been built up. You, culture, a planet, a world has to guard against that to the utmost. And the fact is, this planet has stopped guarding against that and has thrown it all away in the trash. It's very difficult to build up that momentum. This overall sense, this is just a dream, and we don't need to learn the lessons of time. And once that sensibility and clarity is thrown away, you know, then it is very difficult to reestablish it. As a matter of fact, it's better to start all over, in my opinion. You cannot put new wine into old wineskins. Once we've lost it, that sense, and once we're completely given over again to the lessons of time, you're trying to learn the lessons of time, how do you undo that? So that's why we say it's an end of a cycle right now. Cycles do end. We do throw it away, and then we have to start again. It's like a child is obsessed with his toys, and at some point you gotta take the toys away and say, hey, you know, time to grow up. And right now the world's obsessed with all its toys, and it's a very childish place right now. The world has regressed to an extraordinary extent, being very childish and losing the sense of what it's all about. Instead, they're embracing the lessons of time, thinking that, hey, together we can learn the lessons of time. Again, that is a great, great delusion. The lessons of time can never be learned. It's impossible. So how can we say, well, together, if we just do it together, we can do it. We can succeed. You know, we just change the style. Nonsense. Absolute nonsense. And yet, that's the marketing of time. Time tells you, well, you failed. Or it says, well, we're in a new phase now, time says. Okay, he says, you got this far, but it's not far enough, so now let's go into a new phase. Before, it was like you were in individualism, and now it's collectivism or something. Time will keep marketing that thing and saying, hey, this is just the new phase in your progress, your evolution. The evolution of consciousness, how you can progress and eventually succeed. All of this is just a marketing of time. It is all lies. It has no truth to any of it. What we need to do is make declarations. I am, and time isn't. I am in bliss. The lessons of time are nothing. The lessons of time are absolutely nothing. And what I am that I am. And time is nothing. So real progress comes from making those declarations. The rest of the stuff is spinning our wheels. But again, we are very cautious about upsetting time, as it were, the apple cart of time. And we think, oh my gosh, I'm going to be left behind. Everyone else is learning all these lessons. And I'm not learning these lessons. What's going to happen to me? I'm regressing or something. Not true. And I can testify for that, because I basically dropped out of time, of all the lessons of time in this world, and did not go along with all the currents. And even though I seem to lose everything and I'm way behind everyone else, actually I'm very close to awakening. So in wise societies, they place awakening as the top priority. And the world of business and commerce, etc., is a very lower, much, much lower kind of situation, really. It's basically for those who are still very childish. Whereas now in the world, business, commerce, all this stuff is like numero uno, you know. It's backwards. In a sane, responsible society that is not a society of derelicts as we are now, it would just be the opposite. Is those who are not engaged in the high calling of realizing they don't need time at all are seen as very, very, you know, primitive, irresponsible, derelict, childish mentality for now, and that they need a lot of help. They have a very limited role than structuring society, whereas now, just the opposite. Those who are structuring society are the derelicts. So when you have something that's so upside down and backwards, need to start over. There's no way that we can suddenly turn the ship around in this world at this point, at least from my standpoint. I mean, theoretically, you can always dream of something. Time really has no lessons to teach us. It's said that the Holy Spirit can make right use of time, but right use of time is simply to show us that time has no lessons to teach us. The right help is simply to help us to say we don't need any help. We've been thinking that time can help us, but help for what? The only reason why we think we need help is because we want to become prime creator. We want to become something we're not. We don't need any help to be what we are. None whatsoever. We don't need anything to protect what we are, none whatsoever. When we ask for protection, we're asking to protect our goal of becoming prime creator. We're asking to protect this image of being something that we're not. So don't expect the world to turn around. Don't expect the world to suddenly say, okay. Yeah, we don't need the lessons of time, except no. The world is hell-bent on providing even bigger lessons of time and time. Completely enmeshed in that. They say we need real big lessons. Even the idea we need to learn to love one another in time, that's also time. What it's really saying is we need to learn to love time, love the lessons of time. Love lessons of time enough that we continue on with them, and of course having the rugs pulled out from underneath us. You can have people supposedly love each other their whole lives, and then suddenly the rug gets pulled out from underneath them all the time. All the time it happens. Tragedy strikes. You know, there's no stability in time whatsoever. There's no mercy. Time has no real mercy at all. Its purpose is to be merciless, actually. Because it is trying to prepare us for annihilation. So it's a merciless taskmaster saying you must experience even more suffering. You must experience even worse suffering and get used to it and get used to it and be able to suffer. Well, I know I've been through all of this terrible stuff. And did I learn anything? No, not at all. I realize it's all a complete waste of time. In other words, did I learn anything from my suffering? No. The only thing I learned is it's not necessary. Does suffering ennoble you? No, it does not. Do the lessons of time benefit you in any way? No, they do not. Not in any way do they benefit you. They don't benefit anyone. I am and time is nothing. I am and time is nowhere. So how what will happen in the future? Obviously destabilization. And it's always the future. The future is just simply destabilization. It always is. It's always the way. Everything that's built up, which we call life forms, whatever we want to call it, is just temporary, something we define as temporary stabilization. Something symbolizing reality, as it were, symbolizing life, symbolizing stability. And of course, it's completely fragile and vulnerable. And it's only built up so that then it can be destabilized. And then we can suffer the effects of that as a way, as a lesson to try and get used to ultimately total destabilization. So that's why we think, oh, this life is so important. We're so grateful to have this life because eventually we can suffer death here, you see, suffer the death of everything in the world, suffer our death, and we can learn the lessons of that. Okay, and we're so grateful. Whew. He says, wow, it's better than the alternative of not being prepared. So thank you, time, for preparing us for annihilation, you know. That is literally what we're engaged with here. All is completely unnecessary because we can choose a new idea. We don't have to choose the idea of being prime creator, wanting to be prime creator. We don't have to. God's not holding us to that, saying, hey, you're stuck with it. Oh, no. God says you're completely free to choose any idea you want at any time. So it's evident that this type of teaching is not heard very often because I can't find anything. I'm on the internet, bookstores, nothing. Cannot come across this for some reason. But that doesn't mean that it's not valid. It is absolutely valid because it comes out of brutal experience, actually. It's the residue of extreme trauma and suffering and realization that this isn't it. It's the residue of actually experiencing total mental chaos and saying this cannot be experienced other than just an instant. The instant of recognition is instantaneous. This cannot be experienced. This is not an experience. I was not created this way. I cannot ever learn to experience this. It's impossible. So it's the residue of all of that. Whereas most people, they keep thinking that they can get along with time and somehow they can get time to work for them in a way that they want. Not true. They will feel betrayed at some point. They will feel time just sets everyone up. Time's a setup. In other words, life is a setup. The past is a setup. Time is a setup. You're being set up constantly. And instead of saying, oh, I need protection, say, no, what I am and time isn't. Just deny time entirely. It isn't. It's nowhere. I am and time is nothing. I am and time is nowhere. I am and time has nothing to teach me. I am, time is nothing, it has nothing to teach me. That is what gets you enlightened. I have nothing to learn from time. Time has nothing to teach me. I am spirit, I am free. Time has nothing to teach me. I am spirit, I am free, I am as God created me. The lessons of time have nothing to teach me. So when you do this, you feel this temporary, like slight disorientation because you say like, whoa, where's the teacher? What am I gonna do? What do I need to learn? We're so used to learning from time. Everything we do is time trying to teach us lessons here. And then we say, I don't have anything to learn. I don't need to learn anything. God created me complete. There's nothing I need. I certainly don't need to compete. God created me complete. I have no need to compete. God created me complete. I have no need to compete. I have no need to discern or learn. I am and time isn't. No discernment there. I am and time isn't. I am and time isn't. That's a fact. There's no such thing as the past in reality. None whatsoever. So it isn't. Time isn't. It's nothing. It's nowhere. Just like a dream, you're sleeping and you're dreaming all these places, but you're right where you are. All this dream is really nowhere. It's nothing and nowhere. So we're used to lessons of time, we think that we need a curriculum that's teaching us something. No, not at all. We need a curriculum that's adamant, that keeps getting back to the root of it and declare, I am and time isn't. I dwell in bliss and time is nowhere. I am bliss and time is nowhere. So those who are engaged in learning the lessons of time, they think they're making progress. They're not. They're simply wasting. They're just time idly spent. They're just basically aimlessly wandering about with blank minds, as it were. But the belief is so strong in time, in this imaginary past, that we're here to learn lessons. That why else would we be here? Which is true, but the lessons can't be learned. The lessons cannot be learned. We cannot learn to abide in total mental chaos. It's impossible. So, sure, why else would we be here? We're trying. We're here to learn lessons, but we cannot learn them. So, what do we do? We say, hey, let's give a different purpose to being here. I give a different purpose for seeming to be here, which is for everything to reflect the fact that I'm not here in the past. We can give that purpose to it, as everything shows us, oh, I am not here. I am not here at all. I'm not in the past at all. We can give a new purpose to the past. So, I am spirit. I am as God created me. I give a new purpose to the past in order to be free. So the purpose of the past now is everything we see, it shows us, you're not here. You've never been here. You are right where you are. You've never left what you are. You're not here. You've never been here. And so that's a delight. Everything is delightful. The feeling of delight comes from that you're not here. You've never been here. You've never been in the past. You've never been affected by the past. There's nothing you need to learn, except to know that you're not here. Time is nowhere. Say, there's nothing here, it's nowhere, and nothing, and I'm not here. It's not that we don't have an eye, it's just that we're not here. The eye is not here. It's not here, it's not in the past. We most certainly do have an identity. We most certainly are the experiencer and the experience, both. Not one and not the other, both. But we are not here. What we are is not in the past. So the bliss might be like, say, I am not here at all. And that's a happy thing. And everything, we can give the purpose to the past of all these forms, saying, is reflect to us that we're not here. That what we call, like, maybe the people say the vision of no self, okay? But they're really, what's really happening is they give a different purpose to the past to reflect the fact that they've never been here. They're not here, and they've never been here in the past. So that people call that the experience of no self. But no, we do have a self. It's just not in the past, okay? It's just not in the past. So, but that's what you hear the mystics say, I had this experience and there was no self. And then people try to, you know, realize the no self, the condition. But that's, we need a little more context, a little wider picture. It's we have simply decided, I give the past a new purpose. I am, the past is nothing, but I give it a new purpose. For the sake of continuity, I will give the purpose of reflecting that I'm not here. That I've never been here. I've never been in the past. And then all this past reflects that, and you say, I have no self here. There's no self here. And then the experience is one of bliss. But who's experiencing the bliss? The self, the true self is experiencing the bliss. True self is experiencing the fact that it is not in the past. It's never been in the past. Take just a little break here, a little water break. See, we don't have to find a self in the past. There is no self in the past. God created the self. Everything that God creates is eternal and fully complete right now. So we've never had any past. We've never had any process of becoming. So the self is, I am, self is. Past isn't, I am, and the past isn't. So we can have this experience of, oh, I'm not here. I'm not here at all. There's nothing here at all. I'm not here at all. I've never been here. That would be this blissful feeling. This blissful feeling. Absolutely, that is the goal. That is the goal, is to realize that I am not here. I've never been here. What I am has never been here. What I am has no past. Therefore, cannot possibly have been in the past. So, the vision of Christ, the vision of no self, the vision of all that, no I, there's no I, all that is talking about the same situation as the entire world reflects this to you now. All the forms of this dream, the past, simply reflect to you now this sense of that you're not there. You've never been there. And so you feel free. You feel free of the world, like the world has dropped away from you. That's what they say. They say as if the whole world has just dropped away from them. Because why? You're not there. So where's the burden? You know, where's the burden? There are no lessons to be learned because you're not there. Why would you need to worry about learning lessons? Because you're not even there in the first place. You've never been there. And as we know, there are no lessons to be learned in time whatsoever. None. Even though time is a great marketer to try and convince us that there are. Of course, it has to do that. Mind, of course, can be very convincing because it's the presenter of ideas to us. So it's only natural that mind is super convincing to us. So that's why we have trouble. We think, oh, for sure, we there's a way, and this is essential for us. We need to learn the lessons of time. So we're good learners. No, we're not even here. There is no learner here. The idea that we're learning something is, again, just a delusion. You can't learn how to accomplish the impossible. And all lessons that we think we've learned are equally invalid, equally nothing, equally futile. So if everything we think we're learning is equally futile, are we really learning anything? So far so good on this video. I don't know how the audio is going to turn out, again, but my gosh, Ustream became super choppy, can't use it right now. YouTube, I used it once, but then I started getting errors, like, error, please retry, so, you know, that's unstable. Then I tried recording direct to hard disk, but that became unstable. So here I am with the camcorder, plan A, B, C, D. And I also can record directly to an MP3 player, then just put pictures up behind the audio. That's also a possibility. But I think it's helpful to have somebody here, you know, seeing that somebody's actually saying these things. It's not a disembodied voice, as it were. So we're really getting somewhere. The progress is amazing, actually. We've been able to get to the point where we realize this whole vision of no self. We understand what it is now that we're talking about. There's a context to it. And we can say, oh, okay, yeah, sure. This is simply, I chose it. I gave a different purpose to the past for the sake of continuity. I'm now seeing that I've never been here. I'm not here now, and I've never been here in the past. And then this is giving me this feeling of bliss that I simply have always been where God created me in reality, and then eventually I can set all dreaming down entirely. So it's very, there's a big context to it, big picture context, and I feel like, yeah, no big deal. Which is a huge, huge step forward, actually. It's something that used to be present in the world in various high cultures that understood this whole situation, that we don't need the time, lessons of time are completely unnecessary. It's something that we've lost, disintegrated as the so-called Western Enlightenment happened, which, when did that start? 14th century or 15th? I don't know. In other words, science came in. We started, quote-unquote, getting enlightened, meaning really we started getting distracted. And the momentum of all that has brought about now just an incredible state of dereliction in the world. So it's very difficult to reprise that role and get back to seeing the big context, the wide context of vision of no self is simply saying, is just the past Now, I gave a different purpose to it because I'm the one who dreamed in the first place. That's quote unquote the no self, but still, I am the self. I am experiencing this. And it's like, it's not such a big deal. So we're moving past the whole mystical thing of like, oh, no self. Like, and it's like, and making a big religion about that. We're expanding the context, widening the context, so it just seems like, oh, okay, no big deal. It's easy to do. No troubles. It's not a big freak out, or, you know, it's just, I feel like it's just been smoothed out. The road has been smoothed out. And from my standpoint, it provides the foundation for a new civilization at some point, a new world, a new civilization, etc., where the spiritual teaching can be put on the right foundation, and people can truly realize that we've never been in the past. We don't need to learn lessons of time. Instead of just, we don't need, like, you know, just someone had a mystical breakthrough and, oh, I had the experience. There was no self, there was no I. And people say, oh, wow, really, no I. Yeah, I'm going to meditate, see if I can get the feeling, no I. And it's a little bit narrow. It's a little bit narrow is what I experienced. It's so narrow, it's easy to get off track. It's easy to get off track right now in the world. Not that those experiences are invalid. Absolutely, they're valid. When they have experience of no self, it's absolutely valid. But again, if the context is too narrow, it's super easy to be misunderstood and get off track. It doesn't, you know, the momentum doesn't get pushed really strongly in a general way, because we live in a world of derelicts. And yet it seems, the way they promote themselves, it seems like they're like the height of responsibility. We think, oh no, we're going to a golden age, a new age, where we're all so responsible because we're all learning to love one another. And what they're really saying is we're all learning to cooperate with one another to maintain our allegiance to the lessons of time, because it's very difficult to maintain our allegiance. We want to set it down right now, everybody. But again, we're so afraid of that, we think, oh my gosh, so we have to find some way to keep motivated, to hold on to our lessons of time so we don't chuck it. So, of course, we bring in all this song and dance about how beautiful we can make time, how beautiful we can make this world. Let's make the world a beautiful place. You know, all that stuff is 100% trying to maintain loyalty to time. It has nothing to do with salvation, absolutely nothing. And 99.999% of everything you see is exactly that, nothing more. We've thrown away the high culture of realization that we have no lessons to learn in time whatsoever. Time is nothing. I am, and time is nothing. Just imagine how beautiful that sounds. You know, it's more beautiful than any music I've ever heard. I am, and time is nothing. You can listen to your music playlist, thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of songs forever, and you will never hear anything as beautiful as I am, and time is nothing. Right. So why waste all the time on all that music? All that music is just, you know, sugarcoating, trying to sugarcoat time until the rug gets pulled out from underneath you. I have this constant feeling that the rug is going to be pulled out from underneath me. Always. I've always had that feeling here. Constantly. So the idea of enjoying life, how is that possible? Because all around you, you see the rug being pulled out from other people. Your friends, family, loved ones, colleagues, neighbors, fellow citizens, fellow human beings everywhere on this planet. There are many, many, many species on this planet going extinct constantly. So many extinctions, you know, the rug's being pulled out from underneath everything on this planet. We're burning up all the fossil fuels, which is just a collected accumulation of death on this planet for untold millions of years. We're exhausting the resources, we're exhausting ourselves, you know, the whole rug is being pulled out from underneath the entire planet. So how can you pretend, you know, like, oh, it's a nice day. It's, you know, I've got some food, got some friends, and this is great. Everything's fine. I never have had that sense here. For me, it's always been a feeling like the rug is going to be pulled out sooner or later. The rug's going to be pulled out from underneath. You know, this world is entirely treacherous. That has always been my feeling. My feeling of the world is completely treacherous. That is time. It's exactly what time is. Time is treacherous. Time is treachery. Period. Time is treachery. And that's what it's for. And that's what it has to be. Because it's teaching us the ultimate treachery of sudden annihilation of spirit and trying to get us ready for that. So it's like a drill sergeant, Marine drill sergeant, you know, okay, you know, you're sleeping in bed and suddenly at 3 a.m. the bells are going off and then the sergeant, people going through, sergeant's hitting everybody, get out of bed, get out of bed, get up, get your boots on, where are we going? Shut up, get in line, and then put your pack on. Before you know it, you're like running up mountains for 26 miles, and you know, and you're just not dead. People are dropping dead. And my dad experienced that, as a matter of fact. You talk about treachery, here's one. So, my dad is down in Laguna Beach back in the early 40s, late 30s, early 40s. Living life like in paradise down there back that time. Young man, and everything's great. And he goes, he's one day, you know, he's up going, driving through the orange groves in a convertible, and World War II Japanese bomb Pearl Harbor, and December 7th. And suddenly, everybody is rushing down to be enlisted, and he's in college, so he goes into the officer program and enlistment to be a pilot. And so they say, great, you're in the Air Force now, and you're going to basic training, and you're going to, I think it was like Fargo, North Dakota. If that's North Dakota, maybe it's Bismarck or something. But let's put it this way, it's winter. He goes from sunning and surfing on the beaches of Laguna Beach area, driving through orange groves in a convertible, to the next day, he is in basic training in North Dakota in the winter. And it is blizzarding, constantly blizzards, and they're getting thrown out of bed at 3 in the morning and going on these forced marches through blizzards in minus 30-degree temperatures. And they're popping him full of shots. They're putting all these sulfa drugs and antibiotics in him. And he, you know, he's a young, healthy guy. He doesn't need any of that stuff. And the fact people are dying, his college people that came for basic training, they're dying on these forced marches. They're literally dying. And what happened was the son of the editor of the Los Angeles Times died in basic training there simply from brutality. And that's when they had a congressional investigation, and the drill sergeant got court-martialed because he was killing people. Uh-oh, here comes a problem. Here comes somebody. I'm gonna have to put this on pause. All right, I'm back. The pause feature worked. How about that? Tremendous. Had an interruption there. Unnecessary, of course, but I put it on pause, and that's the feature this digital camera has, it, which almost none other have. I mean, that's why I got it. Usually when you hit stop, you have to hit stop on digital camera, the file, that's it, the file's recorded, that's a separate file. This one you can actually hit pause, and then you can hit, you know, start again, and it stays same file. So that is fantastic. So it just worked. Anyway, so you talk about having the rug pulled out from underneath you, and then once basic training was over, you know, he's over flying the Burma hump. You know, just incredible trauma and death and everything. Going from the beach, sunning yourself on the beach of Laguna Beach, like a paradise there, swimming in this beautiful Pacific and surfing and just hanging out with friends and just living, you know, the life of Riley, to this insane brutality, which it shocked his nervous system for a lifetime. It was horrible. Had the rug pulled out from underneath him, you see? Who did that? Time did that. Okay, time did it. So why? time was saying, hey, it's time for you to learn your lessons here. You came here to learn your lessons, and here we go. See, time tells you, see, no matter how happy you are in reality, suddenly you could be annihilated, you know, and we're just giving you a little taste of that so you can get used to it, okay? Totally waste of time, totally meaningless. And of course, he spent the rest of his life trying to reach enlightenment, actually, because he was so upset about that, as anyone would be. When you have something like that, I mean, that was big time trauma, big time trauma. The whole setup is you go from some idyllic place to an absolutely horrible situation of terrible chaos in World War II Pacific Theater. Terrible chaos. And then time is saying, okay, I did you a great favor because I'm teaching you how to adjust to annihilation. You see, eventually time says eventually you'll look back and you'll thank me. That's what time always says about it. Someday you'll thank me for this. No, you won't. Someday you'll realize that you were never there. Which is bliss, which is what we're going for. We'll call it enlightenment, call it whatever you want. It's really experiencing bliss of everything in existence, this imaginary past saying, you're not here now and you've never been here. You've never been here. You're not here and you've never been here and you never will be here. And you say, ah, that's great. I like that news. That's good news. Isn't it? That's the gospel. You talk about the gospel, that's the good news. Is you're not here now, you've never been here, and you never will be here. Hallelujah. And you say, ah, wonderful. I can accept that. I'll accept that from you, Pat. I'll accept that. That's the final lesson, isn't it? That you've never been here. Never have and never will be here. You can't be in the past. What you are cannot be in the past. You can only dream of it. You cannot be it. And this is what we have to look forward to. So I certainly have had the rug pulled out from underneath me many, 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 many times. For instance, I was living in Hawaii on Oahu, fairly near Pearl Harbor, in a beautiful place as a young child. And it was just completely idyllic. It was unbelievably beautiful back then, 1958. And before it was a state. And then eventually we moved back here to the mainland. And I absolutely hated that, never got over it. Because it's just complete shock, you know, it's just so different. And literally, my whole life, I felt like I had the rug pulled out from underneath me because I was in the age 2 to 4 where you really connect with your environment and you feel one with your environment. And I was so into the whole vibe of Hawaii that to come back, suddenly come back and get thrown into kindergarten here, and I just like was completely disoriented, and I never could connect with my environment again here. So I've never felt comfortable here in like a Silicon Valley. I've never felt connected to the environment here. No matter what I do, I feel like I'm a stranger here. So again, that the rug got pulled out from underneath me, where you go from a place like paradise. I mean, where we lived, it was probably the most paradisical place on the planet, actually. We had a beautiful house up on the hill with a tremendous view of the whole bay, Honolulu, Waikiki, Diamond Head, Pearl Harbor, the whole area, looking down, beautiful, long greenery, lush plants, flowers everywhere. Just lived in bare feet and shorts. Rain would come down, rainbows, and just playing with leaves and sticks and walking along the street and going down to the beach and swimming. It was just like a complete paradise, actually. Eating, you know, guavas and mangoes and papayas and pineapples and all this stuff. You couldn't ask for a better situation. And then suddenly, It's all gone. It's all gone. Yeah, you're in the rough and tumble walnut orchards, you know. It just went into shock. That's time. That is time. That's the brutality of time. Time will put you in a very idyllic spot, only to then remove you and to stun and shock you. So don't ever trust the spot that you're in. Don't trust time at all, as a matter of fact. Trust your different purpose. Give a different purpose to the past. You're not giving a different purpose to time. You're giving a different purpose to all the staging of the past, all this staging, this world, this universe. And now the universe is reflecting to you, hey, you've never been here. You were never here. And you never will be here. You never will be here in the past. And that's like constant bliss. And then that cannot be taken away from you. Once you have this, give a different purpose to the past, it can't be, it's not something that can be taken away from you. You can't have the rug pulled out from underneath you. It's impossible. Because you've given a different purpose to the past. That includes everything, all the staging of the past. You've given a different purpose to all the staging of the past, without exception, without exception. So there's nothing that can be, there's nothing that can say, hey, you are here. I see you. You're a self here. And it's there. No, everything says, you're not here. There is no self here. You're not here. There's never been a self here. There's never been an identity here. You're not here. You've never been here. And you never will be here. That's just constant, steady, seamless, steady witnessing to that fact. So you cannot, there's no treachery in that. There's no treachery in that at all. Which is why those in bliss, there's this feeling like there's no worry about treachery at all. And you wonder, how's that possible? Because we think time is completely treacherous. How come the guru doesn't have any feeling of treachery at all? Because again, they're getting witnessing, constant witnessing that they're not here. They've never been here and never will be here. So where can there be any treachery in that? There's no treachery in that. All right. See, this is good stuff. This is really good stuff. I enjoy doing this. Because this is bringing us through the door. Into the door, into the room of bliss, actually. Because we can just say, easily to say, oh, okay, that plant that used to, I used to feel that I'm here with it. And it's, you know, it's part of the why I'm here and the lessons of here. Now the plant is telling me, you're not here. You've never been here. You never will be here. You're completely free of the past. You're entirely free of the past. And yet the plant is telling me this, so I say, thank you, plant. Thank you very much. I say, thank you, tree. Thank you for telling me this. Thank you. I'm so happy to have this truth reflected from you. Thank you, world, for reflecting this truth to me. Of course, we're giving the truth, but the world is reflecting it. So in other words, we have affection with everything we've imagined. We're used to it, so we have some affection to it. So now everything that we had a little bit of affection is now telling us this wonderful truth. All right, thank you, Day. Thank you, Day. Thank you, Day, for reminding me I'm not here. Thank you, Day, for sparkling reminder, perfectly clear reminder that I'm not here. I've never been here. I never will be here. Fantastic. I'm not in time at all. I'm not in time. I'm not in space. I'm not in the past at all. So thank you, time, for that. You see, thank you, time, for that. Not time. Thank you. Thank you, all the staging of time, as it were, all the things. So no matter what anybody says, you're still getting this reflection of them telling you that you're not here. You've never been here, never will be. So they can be blah, 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 blah. It doesn't make any difference what anyone's doing or saying. What you're getting from them is that you're not here. Never been here, never will be here. So how could you be angry at anybody? Because that's all they're telling you. That's the purpose you've given them now. The purpose you've given your brothers and sisters is for them to reflect the fact that you're not here, never been here, never will be here. You don't need any past. You don't have any past. And so, thank you. What else can you say? Thank you. Smile. And, oh, this is great. This is fantastic. Everybody is now telling me the truth. Everything is reflecting the truth to me now. But when we're aware of this is what's going on, then it's seamless. We say, oh, no problem. Okay, the new purpose is finally it's showing up. Blop, blop, fizz, fizz. Oh, what a relief it is. That's the real Alka-Seltzer, is to give the past a new purpose. The past really doesn't have any purpose. I mean, its purpose was to try and teach us what's impossible, which is really not a real purpose at all, is it? And but we can give it a different purpose and say, hey, no, I've never been here. The self has never been here. No self has ever been in the past. Never will be. So, just in time, we're getting to this, crossing these thresholds. Because the rug is about to be pulled out from underneath us. Now, just like on an individual basis, you know, you may be living in Hawaii and idyllic life, which it was, idyllic life, and the rug gets pulled out from underneath you entirely. Never the same. Can't go back. That's individual basis. Collective basis, let's look at it this way. Collective basis is like, hey, 7 billion people. We're all learning, trying to get along. We're developing the global economy. Everybody's got a smartphone. And we're all getting connected. And we all got pretty good teeth. And we're gonna knock out these diseases. And we got, you know, good surgeons and food is nice, and cars are getting better and better, and you know, it's just like there's a feeling like, hey, you know, we could make something pretty cool here. You know, there's that feeling we could really do something here. There's times when the rug gets pulled out of every, collectively, the rug gets pulled out from underneath everybody. Now, we already had that in 2008, where we had the terrible recession, and that was horrible. Horrible. I suffered horribly from that, being in an industry which was just devastated by it, and so many people lost their jobs and went bankrupt and never could recover. And every day you think that you're going to, your life's going to be destroyed. You know, just like hanging on by the thinnest of threads. You know, it's just awful, totally stressful. Oh, but keep it now, but kind of it's coming back, right? Things we're thinking, okay, it's coming back. And we might have one other mini dip, I'm not sure, or we could just go into the rug that's pulled out from underneath us entirely. I'm not exactly sure what the timing on it is. But collectively, what I see is a situation that pulls the rug out from under the entire planet. The entire planet is going to have the rug pulled out from under. Time is going to give this big lesson. That's why there's 7 billion people on the planet right now. Is because time told all these spirits, hey, there's going to be a huge lesson. Y'all got to come in and learn this one. And it's very important, because without the learning this lesson, how are you going to succeed? And so everyone says, okay, I'm in. So we got 7 billion people packed on this planet, ready to have the rug pulled out from underneath them and experience this devastation of chaos. That's why they're here. But of course, you have to set up a feeling like, hey, everything's, the future looks really rosy before you pull out the rug. Because again, we're trying to practice the idea that we're in reality, in the complete, high, total bliss of reality, total felicity and happiness reality, and suddenly we're annihilated. Out of nowhere, surprise, we're annihilated. And how to cope with such a situation and actually appreciate it and abide in it. So in order to symbolize that, we need to have like a kind of rosy situation, and we think, hey, everything's going to be great, the future's going to be wonderful, and then boom, you know, gone, like that. Suddenly, sudden collapse. That's what time does, sudden collapse. Like again, like my dad went through one day on the beach of Laguna Beach, you know, next week or so he's in North Dakota and absolutely freezing to death and being brutalized. I'm in Hawaii one day, I'm on the beach of Hawaii thinking this is my life. Next day I'm completely different place, And say what you want, it's not Hawaii, that's for sure. I said, hey, wait a minute, how come I can't wear shorts, barefoot in shorts all the time? And it's winter here, I'm freezing, what's going on? For the longest time, I refused to give in, you know. I didn't want the room heated, I just kept pretending this is like Hawaii. And I kept thinking that the climate's gonna change and it's all gonna become like it was. It never did, but I kind of refused to accept it, really. So again, sudden change. Rug pull gets pulled out from underneath you, sudden change. And that's what everyone's here for, almost everybody. There are some here to warn you about it. And that is why I used to warn people about traumas that are coming. And I said, hey, I can see what's gonna happen. And they got very angry with me. He said, how dare you interfere with my life that way? What they meant was, they're here to experience that trauma. So the lesson, it's a lesson of time, and they think that they need to learn this lesson to eventually, you know, succeed with their goal. So they don't want to be told about in advance. They want to be surprised by it. And that's what I found out. Again and again and again, I'd tell people what's going to happen, and they always got very, very upset with me. Sometimes extremely so. Because for them, the whole importance of it was to be surprised by it. Because we're trying to symbolize, again, being in reality with no foreshadowing of what's going to happen in sudden annihilation. It's total surprise. We're trying to learn how to deal with the total surprise of annihilation. So these traumas, we want the time sets them up. We want to be surprised by them. So we don't want anybody telling us ahead of time of what's going to happen. So that's why it's so difficult to be accurate when you get older and you've been burned so many times. You realize, boy, you better not tell people accurately what's going to happen as far as time and all this stuff. You know, otherwise they're going to get super angry at you. So it's become more and more difficult for me to pinpoint exactly what's going to happen. I used to be able to pinpoint it exactly. You know, I could pinpoint everything. When I was young, a little child. But gradually you get burned so many times, you get, you know, afraid to do that. So I cannot exactly pinpoint exactly what's going to happen, exactly when. But in general, I can say, in general, that you definitely need to step into bliss. Because this lesson, it is going to be a very brutal lesson for sure. And what time has for us now is really collective collapse, as it were. Collective collapse, sudden, very sudden. But I'm not going to put a time on it. It gets people really freaked out, really freaked out. So I'm probably suppressing this. I'm sure I know, but I'm suppressing it. I knew about 9/11. I didn't know exactly when. I tried to figure it out. I knew it was right after, a little bit after the year 2000, etc. And I pinned it down somewhat, but I didn't get an exact date on it. But again, people don't want to know. They literally don't want to know. That I can tell you, that's an absolute fact. You might think that people say, oh, if only we knew about this bad stuff ahead of time, we'd be so happy. It's the exact opposite. Exact opposite. That's the one thing people don't want to know, because they think that'll ruin the lesson for them. And they think, well, my life's ruined. Why did I come here? I came here for the purpose of being traumatized. And now I'm aware of what's coming, and now I can't claim I wasn't aware. And it's ruined the lesson, totally ruined it. So. Again, that's probably why the gurus don't tell us what's coming, even though they could. There's no question they could. Ananda Maima said she knew everything. She could see everything all time. She knew exactly what was going to happen. But she didn't say. She didn't say. People got angry with her. She said, why didn't you tell us? And she says, it's not wise to do that. But she most certainly knew. Absolutely. Time is not a hidden book, actually. It's not at all. It's only because we want it to be. We want to be surprised, because that's the whole purpose of time, is something happens like, whoa, I didn't see that coming. You know, it caught me by surprise. And then that's like a lesson learned. Like, how do I deal with some sudden trauma I didn't see coming, right? The brutal lessons of time, all completely unnecessary. Totally unnecessary and completely useless to you, all of us, completely useless. So instead of, you know, just trying to be, you know, using precognition to tell everybody what's going to happen, just taking the big picture that time is always brutal. It's always merciless. The lessons it's teaching us are, again, sudden. We get sudden trauma, sudden problems, get the rug pulled out from underneath us. Stress, suffering, misery, all that stuff. And it's all completely useless. So that should be enough to say, you know what, I want to avoid the entire thing. I don't want to try to learn the lessons of time. It's useless. Wasted. Complete waste. I can instead give a different purpose to all the staging. I don't want to throw the staging away because I feel loss of continuity. Keep the staging, different purpose. Now everything is telling me, you're not here, never been here, never will be here. I say, thank you. I'm free. I'm free of the past. I was never in the past. That's what we want to do. That is what we want to do. That's the smart play. That's the smart play. And you say, well, what about all the traumas, blah, blah, blah. No, we've given a different purpose to all these staging. We've given a different purpose. It's no longer serving the other purpose. We've literally given it a different purpose for us. But we're not taking the purpose away from others because they still want it, you see. But for us, everything smooths out. And they're no longer trying to trick us or traumatize us or anything like that, because that's not the purpose that it has for us. We've given it a new purpose. And the only purpose it has now is to tell us we're not here. We've never been here, never will be here. And at the same time, our lives become smooth and easy as far as witnessing to others, etc. But others are still experiencing trauma, absolutely. That's because they want to hold on to that purpose of trying to learn how to become prime creator by how to learn to love total annihilation, which is symbolized by total mental chaos. And of course, there is no way. There is no way. And I speak with conviction on all this because I literally experienced that. So I know for an absolute fact there is no way. So that has given me the leverage I needed to discover the truth of this whole situation here and what to do about it. And align with the great teachers, I was able to realize, hey, they're telling us the truth. They are telling us the truth. Now, the way I express it might be different style, probably. That's to be expected. But this is just how I'm seeing it, how the Holy Spirit's working through me, of saying, hey, you can give a different purpose to all the staging of the past, saying you're never here, you've never been here, never will be here. Of course, we don't need this past. So it's not like we're losing something. We have all of reality. So we don't need any past. We don't need to think that the past is part of what we are, that's part of our home. We don't need that at all. We need to realize it's not part of our home. It's never been part of our home, never will be part of our home. That's what we need to realize. So I really hope this audio is coming through. Maybe I have to learn to not whisper when I talk. But if I do that, then, you know, people... I don't want people to say, what in the world is he doing? What is he doing? What is he talking about? Because the world is not up to speed on any of this stuff right now. The world is in extreme dereliction. Derelicts. If the world can be symbolized, it's a boat full of pirate, derelict pirates, really, is the way the world is right now. It's yo-ho-ho and a bottle of rum. Of course, they're all thinking that they're not derelicts. They're all thinking that they're really with it. It's not true. It's absolutely not true. They are simply learning to try and embrace time more tightly. And that's being derelict. So when you're in a room full of derelicts, you don't want to speak too loudly because they don't take it kindly to it, because they feel you're interfering with their learning the lessons of time, of which to them is all important. I mean, from a standpoint of ignorance, it seems lessons of time are completely important. Without them, you're going to experience total annihilation with no defenses, no reason, no capability to deal with it. So they feel that time is like their absolute necessity. And how dare anybody question this. And so if you say that they're being derelict, they say, what are you talking about? We're embracing time more and more. We're not derelict. That's the culture we live in right now, so you can't speak too loudly in this culture, actually. Now, what if you're listening to this and you don't quite get it? Are you struggling with this? Of course you struggle with it. That's the whole point. If I was telling you something you already knew, there's no struggle, what would be the point? The point is, of course, you're going to say, whoa, this is disorienting. Whoa, wait a minute, you know, what is true? And like, wow. And try to interpret it in some way, of course. That's the whole, the struggle, the spiritual path of struggle. As you're struggling to get out of this dereliction, when you're surrounded by drunk derelicts, you know, it's pretty tough to sober up. It is. I had a terrible time in this world. Terrible time. When you're surrounded by very sober, responsible people, then it's easy to be that way. So when you have an entire planet that's just extremely derelict, it is indeed rather intimidating and difficult to sober up, but it's not impossible. I basically had to keep my distance from everybody, is how I've done it. You know, avoid the influence of people as much as possible, because they're all completely into the lessons of time. Now, I know we've been told that we're supposed to spend all our time among the saints and the sages and so on, but that's a bygone era. Where do you go for that, really? Yeah, it's very, very tough, actually, for that right now. We don't have a culture. The culture no longer supportive of that whatsoever. The derelicts are running the show. So because of all this dereliction, we need declarations. I am and time isn't. I am and time isn't. I am and time isn't. And what we've developed in this video is the context for this practice is to give a different purpose to the past, the staging of the past. What does that mean? The earth that we walk upon, the bodies that we're walking around, the animating, the plants that are growing out of the earth, the trees, the shrubs, the flowers, the flora, the fauna, the animals that are walking around on this earth, the bugs, the microbes, the air, the atmosphere, the fire, the elements, the planets, the stars, the moon, the whole planet, creativity, expression, modes of expression here, everything.